Welcome to the program. I'm your host, Neil Howard, here on Health Professional Radio. Glad that you could join us. Going to have a conversation with Dr. Brad Berger. He's a board-certified child and adolescent psychiatrist at Rogers Behavioral Health in Miami. And he's joining us on Health Professional Radio to talk about depression and mental health issues in men that are often overlooked or simply not talked about due to social norms. Welcome to Health Professional Radio, Dr. Brad Berger. How are you?
Good. Thanks for having me.
Now, I did say that, of course, you're a board-certified child psychiatrist. A bit of background about yourself.
I work for Rogers Behavioral Health, which specializes in treatment for obsessive-compulsive disorder, mood disorders, and we also have a newer program that specializes in anxiety and depression that go along with autism.
I said that we were going to talk about some of these issues that affect men. Are there mental health issues that only affect men?
There's not. I mean, most mental health issues really affect men and women. So, I mean, there are some that affect men more and some that affect women more. But I'd say it's pretty general.
Now, when it comes to men having mental health issues and not talking about these mental health issues, is it because they're not seen as severe or as stressful in women? Or what is the reason that they're not talked about?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's just stigma, just like mental health in general. A lot of people don't like to go seek help because there's a stigma. You should be able to kind of pull yourself up by your bootstraps and tackle the mental health issues. But I think it's probably a little bit more prevalent in men just because of stereotypes, male stereotypes that, you know, we should be tough and we should be able to handle our own problems.
Now, we're taught basically to be that way from an early age. Is that something that is part of some of these mental health conditions? The that pressure at a young age to be a certain way as opposed to developing the way that you're going to be on your own?
You know, I think that you can probably get an increase in anxiety symptoms from that, because if you're taught that and you feel like you just can't do that, then you're going to increase your anxiety. You can get more obsessive compulsive symptoms, more depression. So it's certainly possible. I think luckily there's still a stigma that's out there, but I think it's getting better. I think that with more people like celebrities and sports stars that are going public about getting treatment for mental health, I think it's normalizing it somewhat. I think the stigma's still there. And I think there's a cultural stigma also. I think it's, in some cultures, the stigma is still very, very profound, but I think it's getting a little bit better over time.
When you say it's getting better over time, do you mean that there are certain mental health conditions that are being not necessarily normalized, but accepted and in some cases even capitalized on, getting more attention maybe when some other conditions should be getting the attention? Not to minimize bipolar disorder, but there was a time back in the 60s, the 70s, when bipolar or manic depressive was this huge thing that nobody wanted. They even had songs about it, you know. Now it's kind of like, oh, bipolar, well, what other things do you have going on?
Almost like it's a trendy diagnosis now.
Yeah.
I think that bipolar is often misdiagnosed, and I think that we use it in the lay community just when someone's moody, or they're bipolar. Mm-hmm. And so obviously if you're going by true strict DSM-5 criteria, a lot of the people that will go around saying I'm bipolar don't really have bipolar. Mm-hmm. But yeah, mm-hmm. Talking about it definitely gets it a little bit more accepted. I think probably what comes to mind in terms of diagnoses is PTSD. I mean, there's just been a lot of media coverage for PTSD and a lot of people talking about it, a lot of political actions for getting more treatment for PTSD. So I think that is allowing war veterans and people, you know, that have gone through sexual trauma or physical trauma to actually get out there and get some treatment, which is wonderful because, you know, they really need it.
And you know, just my opinion, focus on PTSD, I think, is a good thing because it reveals some other serious mental conditions as well, especially in us veterans.
Yeah, absolutely. Depression, anxiety that go along with PTSD. So you're getting some media exposure or just exposure in general about those conditions also.
You know, talking about PTSD, do you think that children of military people, both on base and off base, are more affected by some of these conditions, OCD and other things, than, say, civilians?
I think, yeah, the military, the dependents, Definitely. I think for anxiety and depression, especially separation anxiety, you see that probably more. I can't cite any studies, but I think you're going to see that more in dependents, and probably even more now, because in the military, when I served, I didn't go overseas. I didn't get deployed. But nowadays, when you're in the military, you expect to get deployed. Mm-hmm. And so that obviously creates a huge strain on the dependents that have to stay back. And I think that you're going to see increased levels of anxiety, separation anxiety in the kids, depression in the spouses that stay back that have to kind of hold down the fort, so to speak. So, yeah, I think you probably see increased incidence of that. And again, hopefully – the military has been pretty good about being proactive about getting treatment for the dependents, and hopefully that continues.
When you're talking about some of these conditions that manifest early in life, but they aren't really diagnosed until later in life, do you think that the patient or who's dealing with this condition and they're struggling with trying to deal with the stigma of the condition as it progresses, does the stigma in their mind get bigger, even though maybe some of the stimulus from that stigma isn't being presented?
That's a tough one to answer, I would say. I think, typically things like schizophrenia, OCD, they manifest in late teens, early adulthood. So they may have some soft signs when they're younger, but typically, hopefully, we've gotten better at diagnosing kids that actually have true OCD symptoms or true schizophrenic symptoms. And obviously, schizophrenia in kids is pretty rare. But if you have a kid that has OCD symptoms that is not treated, and as they get older, I think that it becomes more difficult to treat them, not so much because the stigma is worse, just because the symptoms become more ingrained. So I think the stigma is probably going to be there regardless, but I do think that there is a stigma even stronger in younger kids to get treatment because they don't want to look odd. They don't want to look weird to their friends. And so they don't want to come to treatment. So it's a very difficult thing for a child and adolescent psychiatrist or a therapist to keep kids in therapy and treatment because they want to normalize everything and not be different, not be odd. So they're not as committed to doing the treatment as, let's say, a younger adult or an adult.
How do you convince the parents or deal with the parents who have a son that's showing signs of a mental disorder or is actually being treated and they themselves are reluctant to do certain things because of stigma?
It's a good question. It's interesting. It's kind of like you have both ends of the spectrum. I have some parents who are convinced their kid does have major mental illness, and I'm not thinking that that's true. So sometimes it's taming them down to just telling them that it's just the problems aren't necessarily a psychological or a psychiatric diagnosis. It's just adolescence. Mm-hmm. Okay. There are those that don't want to get treatment because of the stigma. There's nothing wrong with my kid. And honestly, sometimes it's just time because that as the illness progresses, they're going to have more symptoms. And sometimes you just have to wait it out, try to see them, periodically and just kind of point out, well, this is not typical behavior until the parents are on board. They usually come around because obviously mental illness doesn't just stay stagnant. It usually gets worse as you get older if it's not treated.
In wrapping up, Doctor, where can our listeners go online and get much more information about how to deal with mental illness, especially in boys, and how to deal with themselves if they realize that a loved one or someone is having some problems?
So NAMI is a really good resource. It's National Association of Mentally Ill. Obviously, you can go online to Rogers Behavioral Health. They have a lot of information on our website and also ways to reach out to get treatment. Those would probably be the two places that I would start.
Well, I thank you for coming on the program. I know it's just a short period of time to cover a lot of information, but hopefully we'll be able to get you back in the future. Thanks for joining us today.
Great. Thank you. Take care.
You've been listening to Health Professional Radio. I'm your host, Neil Howard. Transcripts and audio of this program are available at hpr.fm and healthprofessionalradio.com.au.